Hello friends, this video on agriculture part 5 is brought to you by examfear.com. No more fear from exam. Now, if we actually look at agriculture and the Indian economy, because we saw that India is an agricultural country, but what we need to see is agriculture contributing to our economy? Now that is an important thing. So how do we know that? So that is decided by GDP. And what is GDP? So GDP stands for gross domestic product. And what does that mean? So it basically determines the economic performance of a country. So if the GDP value is increasing, that means the economic performance of the country as a whole is also increasing. Now it is nothing but, you can just understand it simply like this, that it is a measurement or a monetary measurement of the market value of a particular good or service. So for any particular sector, for example, if we talk about India, so if you look at this, this is a true data. So if you see in the year 2013-14, the GDP was 6.6. In 14-15, it was 7.2. In 15-16, it was 7.6. So we see that the GDP of India is increasing, which shows that the economic performance of India is also increasing. But how do we get this GDP? So this GDP comes from different sectors. For example, it comes from agriculture sector, it comes from industry sector, it comes from services sector, and they all add up to give an overall or net GDP, right? So even though the overall GDP growth rate is increasing, but if you look at the contribution to GDP from the agriculture sector, that is reducing. In fact, this reduction is tremendous, from 4.2 to minus 0.2. After that, there is a slight increase, but overall it is decreasing. So that means agriculture is not really contributing to the GDP of the Indian economy. So what do you think? Is that a good thing? Of course not, because agriculture is something, it is a sector where more than 80% of the Indian population is involved. So ideally, agriculture should contribute maximum to the overall GDP of the Indian economy, but that is not happening, which shows that agriculture is in a very, very bad shape, right? So what we understand is the share of agriculture in the GDP is declining, which is a serious concern. Yes, of course. Now, what are some of the adverse effects of this, or what are some of the causes for this? For example, what is happening because agriculture is not contributing to GDP? So what is happening as a result of that? Lack of employment opportunities in agriculture. So you do not have many employment opportunities in agriculture. So we actually see a lot of unemployment in disguise in agriculture sector. Reduced public investment in agriculture sector. Now since agriculture is not contributing to the GDP, so no one is ready to invest in the agriculture sector. Decreased subsidy on fertilizers. What is subsidy? So subsidy is a low cost of an item so that it can be used by everyone. So you would have often heard that, you know, that the government is giving a particular thing at a subsidized rate to the poor people. So it is like a minimum cost at a minimum price. Now it is seen that that subsidy price is also decreasing on fertilizers. So there is less subsidized rates for the fertilizers. And as a result, what is happening? Not too much of subsidy on fertilizers. So therefore, from the farmer's perspective, fertilizers are becoming very expensive for them to buy, right? Decrease in import duties on agriculture production, right? Now, as a result of all these, what is happening is, for a farmer, the cost of production is increasing because he has to buy fertilizers, he has to buy insecticides, pesticides, irrigation techniques, and all of that. And the output that he is able to generate is not worth it, right? So basically, if we, in simple words, we can say that in today's date, agriculture in terms of economy is not in a good shape in India. F- food security system. Now, we all know that agriculture gives us food, but it is also important that we ensure that the food reaches to each and every citizen of the country. Now, again, India is a country with a large population. Are we able to ensure that we are able to produce that much of food? More on top of that, are we able to ensure that the food is reaching all the people in our country? Now, if we want to provide food security, we need to understand how the food security system is taken care in our country. Now, the moment we talk about food security system, we talk about something called buffer stock. That means extra stock. So we keep some stock of food extra. Why? So that if we come across a season when there is not so much of food production, if some mishap happens in a particular region in India, so we have the buffer stock to take care of those accidental seasons as well as regions. Not only that, we have a system called the PDS, that is the public distribution system. Now, the role of public distribution system is that the food grains and the essential items are provided to the BPL population at subsidized rates. Now, BPL refers to below poverty line. So, people who are extremely poor. So, we cannot sell the food items at the same price to the BPL people as we do it for other people who are economically sound, right? So what we do is we stock some of the food items and provide them at subsidized rates, at low rates to the below poverty line population. So what happens is the farmers in the villages or in the agricultural areas, they grow the crops, right? Now what happens is from those areas, now there is a corporation called FCI, that is Food Corporation of India. Now, the function of FCI is that it takes the food items from the farmers at minimum support price. So, FCI will take these food items from the farmers at the minimum support price. That means the minimum possible price. Right? And who decides this minimum support price? This is decided by the government. Right? And now what does it do? Now FCI will stock all these food items. So that is the main function of FCI. That FCI will take the food grains from the farmers at MSP, that is minimum support price, and then they will stock the food grains properly. And where will they use the food grains? These stocked food grains will then be supplied, or they will then be distributed to the below poverty line population at subsidized rates. So the function of PDS is to distribute the food grains and the items which were stocked by FCI to the eligible population. That is, and who is the eligible population? The below poverty line population. Unfortunately, in India, what happens is many a times the people who are actually below poverty line, they are not included in this list. And some of the people who are above poverty line, they are, you know, kind of, they get into this list. So it is actually a very tricky thing. But it is important that we segregate these two population correctly and then ensure that food reaches to one and all. Now, when we talk about food security, it is extremely important that we take care of a farmer's security, because food security cannot be ensured without a farmer's security. Now, let us see what happens to the farmers. Now, we see that the farmers gradually get segregated into two classes: big farmers, that is the rich farmers, and small farmers, they are the poor farmers. Now, all the facilities, for example, free power is made available to a section of farmers, not to all the farmers. And those who get this facility, what do? Since they have free power, they use this power to pump groundwater. Now, when they have so much of water, they start growing water-intensive crops even during dry season. For example, crops like paddy, they need a lot of water. Ideally, they should be grown during the rainy season, like during the season when we have a lot of water. But these farmers, they will start growing the water-intensive crops even during dry season because they have pump. They have the free power to pump groundwater, right? As a result, they get facility to construct deeper tube wells. Now, when they have deep tube wells, what will they do? They will extract more and more groundwater, and as a result, they will reduce the groundwater will get replenished, right? The groundwater will get over. So this reduces the water table in that area. Besides that, since they are growing water intensive crops, they are able to grow more crops even during the off season. So they are able to make better money. Now when they have better money, they can use that money for better storage facilities. They also have better marketing facilities. So as a result of all of these, what is happening? This section of farmer, they are becoming rich. So they are the big farmers. Right, so they have more money, they are making more money, they have access to all the resources, they have money, they are leading a good life. But on the other hand, there are other section of farmers who are not getting access to all of these. So what is happening to them? They face water crisis because all the water is being pumped up by the deep tube wells of the big farmers. So the small farmers are facing water crisis. So when they face water crisis, they also have to pay high price for the inputs because they have to spend more money for the irrigation methods because they do not have water, right? So they end up paying high price for the inputs. They have poor storage and marketing because everything is linked, right? When they do not have money, they cannot afford good inputs. When they do not have good inputs, they do not get good output from their fields. As a result, they have a poor sale. And all of these together make them the small farmers or the poor farmers. So what we see is because of these differences, the rich farmers gradually become richer and the poor farmers become poorer. So the gap between the rich and the poor farmers increase. And big farmers start controlling the market. So big farmers, they are rich. So they influence the market. They decide the market price. Right? So they get all the power and the poor farmers, they suffer. Now, when we talk about food security, do you think that there will be food security without a farmer security? Obviously not. That is never possible. So we need to include these poor farmers as well and try to give them some sort of security. Right? So what we observed is, due to excess use of water, because the big farmers who get access to everything, they get too much water. Due to excess use of water, excess use of fertilizers and misuse of free power, because these are the facilities which are given to just one section of farmers. So it is important that we ensure that all these facilities are evenly distributed to all the farmers so that none of them have excess of it to misuse. At the same time, none of them are deprived of it. Because due to excessive use of all of these, what is happening is there are problems which are arising. For example, due to waterlogging, the crops are getting spoiled. There is soil degradation due to excessive use of fertilizers. There is an imbalance in crop varieties because the big farmers have all resources. They control the market. They control the market price. So they tend to grow only the more valuable crops. So as a result, there are some crops which are grown all the time. There are some crops which are never grown. So these are the problems which are arising due to this division of farmers into rich and poor. So it is important that if we really want to ensure food security to everyone, it is also important that the farmers are secured. All the farmers should be given equal opportunity. They should be given equal access to all the resources so that all of them can get similar output and can lead a better life. So these are some of the issues. Thank you. Please visit examfear.com for free quality education. You can learn with a simple 4-step learning process wherein you can watch video lessons, you can ask your questions, you can refer notes, and you can take a free online test. We have content for class 6 to 12 on physics, chemistry, mathematics, and biology along with practical videos. So please subscribe to our channel for daily updates. Thank you.